Hello and welcome to Capital Conversations. This is NET News' weekly series of discussions with policymakers whose decisions affect Nebraskans' lives. With me today is Senator Kathy Campbell of Lincoln, the chairwoman of the Health and Human Services Committee. Thanks very much for coming in.
Good morning, Fred.
I want to ask you about the latest piece of legislation that you've had that's been in the news, which is an increase in benefits for recipients of aid to dependent children, generically known as welfare. Tell us what your reasoning behind bringing that bill was and what it would have done.
You know, I started taking a look at TANF, and TANF is the block grant that comes from the federal government.
Okay, we're going to have to acronymize here.
TANF stands for Temporary Aid to Needy Families.
Okay.
It was established in 1996. A lot of people know it as welfare to work. The whole objective of giving the TANF funds, the temporary aid, is to help families over a spot and get them back into a work activity.
Right, and as a matter of fact, it's limited for each person to like 5 years, right?
Absolutely, in their lifetime.
Uh-huh.
So there's a number of people think, well, you know, somebody stays on welfare forever. That's not true anymore. They only have 5 years. Now, a family can have funding for a period of time, get back on their feet, get a job, and then something else happens, an illness, or they lose their job. We saw that certainly in the recessionary period. And then they can come back on. But the total accumulation is 5 years.
Okay. So for like a mom, single mom with two kids, it's been at $364 a month for
correct.
30 years.
Nearly 30 years,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And part of what I looked at when I started studying this issue, and I've looked at it really over the last 2-3 years, we've been following what the state is using TANF for, and we discovered that they were accumulating, the department was accumulating a fairly large reserve.
That would be the Department of Health and Human Services.
Correct. And they were accumulating this reserve over time, and last December, the state auditor, now the lieutenant governor, issued a report on the audit of TANF and said there's a $55 million reserve and you really ought to be using that for the benefit of Nebraskans. So that sort of everything came together and I put together LB 89 because we hadn't had an increase in the maximum payment for nearly 30 years. And this is meant to be aid to dependent children. This is meant to prevent children from going into the child welfare system.
So your bill in the form that it passed would have increased that monthly benefit by about $100 a month for that.
Yes, that's correct.
And the governor vetoed that.
Yes, the governor was concerned. His budget office was saying, well, if you use every single dime that comes in the block grant plus the reserve, you will be in 5 years, close to 5 years, you would have eaten up all that reserve. And his concern, I think, was some sustainability, stretch that reserve a little bit more. Now, that's assuming you're going to spend every dime. The trend out of the department has been over the last 10 years that they have never spent, well, except for 2 years, but they have not spent that total grant. So that accumulation. One could argue, and that's what I proposed in 89, was that they probably aren't going to use all that money. But the governor had a valid concern, and in his veto message, he said, if you looked at a sunset, I would be willing to relook at the issue.
Sunset meaning take the benefits back down after four years.
That's correct. After when their projections were that the reserves would run out.
Okay.
And my concern about that, a sunset, was then in the fifth year or whenever, you would say to somebody, well, I'm sorry, but your payments are now going to go back to what they were in 1985. And we would have lost the ground in trying to make up and say, really, we ought to be helping families at a better benefit than just 1985.
So where do things stand now?
Well, I thought a lot about the issue, and the next day I talked to several people and started having the legislative fiscal office run some options for me. And late that afternoon, the next day, I put in a call to the governor's office and spoke to the chief of staff and said, I may not be favorable to a sunset, but I have another option. Is that something that the governor would look at? And the response was yes. So basically, we started then exchanging information in terms of figures and what does this option do versus that option. And then this week, after having looked at it over the weekend from the governor's budget people, we got together Monday afternoon at 2 o'clock. And started saying, well, what do we think is the best option here? And by 4 o'clock, we'd run the figures and knew that we could make the goals work for both what the governor was looking for and what I was looking for. And I think it's a good compromise.
You scaled back the increase a little bit and you limited future increases.
Well, yes. What we did was we were going to increase the benefit by 60% and then go to 65 and then
well,
go to
not,
70.
Not 60% of the base, but you were going to hitch it to some federal.
Correct. Now, we've had a CPI index on
the certificate consumer price index.
Correct. The certificate of need is what you judge on the eligibility. And that's what has kept pace. That certificate of need has kept pace. That's what's been tied to the CPI. But now what we did in the compromise is we said, okay, we're going to go to 55% of what we were doing and freeze that percentage, but allow over time it to be tied to that CPI.
Why is it so complicated? I mean, even hearing you describe it, you know, it's almost impossible to follow.
It's too bad that we don't have a whiteboard here.
Oh, that would be a nice addition.
I think that your followers certainly could see. It's really not as complicated because the federal government in many programs has indexed it to the Consumer Price Index, the CPI. So that is not unusual. That was an existing statute. So all we did was say instead of a strict amount, we're going to have a percentage. So that's really the biggest change. And what that did from the governor's perspective is it stretched out that reserve fund to, well, it will go, we think, into the 10th year.
And by then, all bets are off anyway.
And really, over a 10-year period, I would say over a 5-year period, the legislature and the governor can watch what is happening with this fund. And if we need to make another adjustment, we can. I firmly believe that they'll look at it before the 10th year.
So bottom line for this mom with two kids that we've been talking about, instead of getting a $100 increase, she's going to get?
$72.
Okay, per month.
Per month. And then in 2 years, it would be priced to the CPI, and then in another 2 years. And the point being there is you don't then let this languish for another 30 years before you make an adjustment to those payments.
So I was struck by in his veto message, the governor said he had these concerns about sustainability, but it was well-intentioned, and then you worked out this compromise. Is that unusual in your experience when a governor vetoes something?
Yes, very unusual. I think we've had before, Governor Heineman at times would send a letter, even if he was signing something, but say, you know, you ought to really be looking at this, or there were he'd outline some conditions in future legislations, perhaps. But to come back and say, if you made this, you know, if you were willing to look at this, then I might rethink it. That's very unusual. And I would hope that in the future, I think both sides here, meaning the legislature and the governor, have realized that while all of us who've been here 6 years, you kind of know the process and you know what's going on and how things are handled. But you have to keep in mind we now have a new governor and a new administration. And to some extent, I think we both learned here that we're going to have to communicate a whole lot earlier. The senator's saying, are you sure you've got a question? Are you sure there's not something here? As well as I think the governor will start, maybe looking at things a little earlier, because it's much harder after you veto a bill to then go back and try to make that adjustment. Here, it was a little easier, but there are many bills in which that's not going to happen.
So you're going to get a welfare increase. You, several years ago, got prenatal benefits for illegal immigrants. You're the champion of expanding Medicaid.
I am.
And you're a Republican.
I am.
Can you explain that?
When I served on the Lancaster County Board, I spent a lot of time looking at budgets and money. And as my husband used to describe me, he goes, you know, you're probably a moderate to more liberal on social issues, but you're still a fiscal conservative. I mean, you still pay very close attention to the money. And to some extent, those tenets of that in believing that government isn't the answer to every problem. I mean, I've worked in the nonprofit sector. I understand the importance of the community also playing a part in helping people. So I am not one of those that thinks government is an end-all be-all. I also have stayed in the Republican Party because I believe that there are people like me who may be more liberal on the social issues, still believe in the tenets of the Republican Party, because I believe both of the parties should have a fairly broad tent.
And what kind of a reception do you get from your fellow GOP members?
Well, you know, I think there are probably some people in the Republican Party who would ask the same question you ask, why are you still here? But a number of people who have supported me through almost 24 years of being an elected official, still come back to me and say, you know, I support what you're doing. I support the issues you're taking up. And those are Republicans.
Okay. Well, thank you for that explanation. And I appreciate your coming in and talking these issues over with me.
Thanks,
this Fred. Is NET News Capital Conversations. We're on the web at netnebraska.org/news. We'll have another one next week and hope to see you then.